to our IAMPRO community and welcome to our Q&A session with industry professionals. Today, we have the amazing Gary Beadle. He is best known for his work in EastEnders, Patrick Melrose, the upcoming Star Wars series for Disney called Andor, and he did an amazing run at the National Theatre Court with the show called Le Blanc, which was totally amazing. So with no further ado, let me get in Mr. Gary Beadle.
Well. Hello.
How
are you? All good?
I'm really excited about getting inside your head because I know what a fun place it is to be.
Well, there you go. Not much going on lockdown, so everybody welcome.
Good. That's good. Open it up for all of us at IAMPRO. So yeah, we're going to jump straight in. Gary, can you tell me a little bit about your first job and how you broke into the industry? I think it's really helpful for our community to hear stories of people's journey.
Yeah, well, it's kind of strange, actually, because believe it or not, it started quite a long time ago. I mean, I was a child actor like yourself, and my brother was a playwright. And I used to do little shows, and I got spotted by a woman called Anna Scher, who was a very reputable sort of drama teacher back in the day, taking feral kids off the streets and stuff, and then giving them some kind of theatrical classical training. So I was fortunate enough to be there alongside people like Dexter Fletcher, Kathy Burke, and many others, Phil Daniels, all sorts of people. So I learned my craft there and sort of gradually just got into this the industry through that. It started off as more of like after school classes, and then if you show some potential, I guess you sort of got put forward for auditions and stuff, for children's stuff. And I did a TV show called Murphy's Mob. So my first professional job was when I was about 10 years old, and it sort of started from there. Really, I just kind of just went on from one job to the other, and I was very fortunate. But I was sort of surrounded by those sorts of people with the same ambitions.
That's amazing. So just joining groups after school and immersing yourself in those environments can be really beneficial.
Absolutely. It's always nice to be with like-minded people, you know, in terms of creativity and stuff. So it was a bit of an escapism because I'm from Southeast London, Bermondsey. And, it, you know, during those times, it wasn't the most sort of pleasant, tranquil environment, let's say. So that was escapism, going off to Islington and just sort of working in this kind of community hall with other actors and stuff, which is where I learned my craft, really. Yeah.
So can we talk about your craft? This is exciting. So can you talk me through, first of all, I always ask people on here about their self-tape process because it's a really important part of getting into the industry these days. There's no escaping it. It's painful, but it's true.
Absolutely.
So tell me how you set yours up. Do you do it at home? Do you pay someone? Like, what do you do?
It depends, really. So before, I always would go to a studio at my agencies, which they had a space for. And I just like the idea of sort of, you know, just going out and traveling to somewhere like it's an audition and then recording even then, you know. But of course, times have changed. So we've all had to adapt, all right? And so we've all had to kind of whatever little money we can get together or borrow or scrape by, buy yourself some kind of backdrop, you know. If you can get a decent camera phone, that's great. And when it comes to, because I've been doing a few actually quite lately, believe it or not, it's been quite strange and I'm just never going to get used to it, but I do enjoy the challenge. Get a friend who just speaks on your whatever. If you've got another electronic device that they can talk through, whether it's a computer or another phone, or, you know, somebody who sounds a separate entity, and they don't have to be in the room reading the lines. So I've been doing things like that, and funny enough, I won't go into it, but I've got one or two jobs doing that, so it can be done. But what's really good about recording from home, which is what I really like, is that you actually get more time than you could possibly imagine. You know, there's no like, oh, 10 past 10, I'm in the room and I've got to be there on point. You can record it, and you could even, if you do it, you know, say you've got a tape that you need to deliver on Monday, you record it on the Saturday and the Sunday, you can choose your best takes, and you can choose I think, you know, with, they get to see more people with this kind of technique, and, you know, you get a chance to do your best take. So I've kind of learned to embrace that, really, you know. It's less nerve-wracking than auditions because you're the one that sends it.
Definitely has its pros and cons, doesn't it? Because there's a certain energy that comes with being in a live audition.
Yeah.
And for me, you know, I have quite a busy mind, and so I might spend quite a lot of time overthinking it, going, "Oh, I didn't do that right," like constantly go over it. You know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean.
But I think it does definitely give us more opportunity to perfect it, you know, and like you say, take your time with it. I want to know what happens when you get a script. So how do you break it down? Can you take me, so if we're talking, we're going to start with a TV show, because I know the process is different in theatre and film, with a TV script. How do you begin to break it down, and how do you begin to find a character?
Well, as we both know, you know, TV is, you know, not being disrespectful to TV compared to other genres, but it is very instant, right? It's like, got to bring the character, got it now. You know, back in the day, you used to have rehearsals before. I mean, they are bringing that back, you know, rehearsals before filming for television, but you certainly get rehearsals in cinema, do you know what I mean, on good budget stuff, and certainly in theatre. So with TV, I guess with me, I mean, I've never really been good with auditions. I'm not going to lie. I'm not, you know, I'm just like, I feel like I'm an also-ran, just like most people, you know. So what I do is I get myself into a deluded space where I think, well, if I know everything, then I'll have some idea of what I'm doing. So in that sense, I'll go out of my way, which actually helped me just generally when it comes to finding out information, to actually just research on the type of character you're playing, where they're from, what kind of environmental upbringing they might have had, you know, just really just try and get a three-dimensional thing on, objective on the whole thing, you know, where, I mean, I like playing characters, and I have played characters like American characters, and I've played characters up north and characters with different dialects, Caribbean, you know, I've just done Steve McQueen's, you know, latest BBC drama called Small Act. And we all had to study, like, you know, Caribbean accents, you know, like really good, like East Caribbean. And my family are from Jamaica, but I was born in London, but I had to learn an East Caribbean accent, which is completely different, right? And, you know, you learn these little things. And I had so much fun, you know, I was aware, but I had so much fun into finding out why people speak the way they do, you know, why, because with a dialect and a character comes an attitude, and there's a reason for that attitude. So it's just nice to try to do all that research. I mean, you can Google to your heart's content on just all those things, and just make your own decisions as to how you're going to play the character, you know.
Yeah.
I think it's always good to take risks. Don't ever feel you have to fill in every comma and full stop on the script. You can breathe, you can stop, you can pick up, you can do your own inflections and be really loose and be really instinctive. And more than anything, just be individual, because no one will be a complete blueprint of your inflections if you take risks, you know? So, yeah, that's what I really enjoy.
It's being brave, isn't it?
Yeah, brave. And enjoy the process, you know? You know, us artists, you know, we love it. It's escapism, you know?
Yeah, of course.
Souls,
we like being somebody else
hiding behind something, do you know what I mean? And that's it. So it's not about adoration for us, it's just about, I mean, I'd like to just do it and nobody know who I am, really, do you know what I mean? That would be, a lot of people go, oh, I'd rather do less and just like everybody to know who I am. Well, that would probably be the wrong reasons, you know. Enjoy the process, own the process, and know that you can only do what you're doing, and don't feel a slave to the script or slave to anything, you know. Not at the audition stage anyway.
Physicality. Now, I watched you in Patrick Melrose, and honestly, you blew me away. I was like, oh my god, that's my friend, you're so good. Just like the whole character that you took on and the physicality of the character. I don't know if you've done much physical training or whether that's been useful at all, but how do you find that, like, within a character? Is it something that comes immediately to your mind, or is it something you work on in a rehearsal room? Again, theatre and TV, theatre, you have more time, but talk to me about that.
Well, you know, look, we all know characters and we all see things and we log them. Sorry, this is my little stick I usually keep in my hand, just the therapeutic thing. You know, we all meet characters and see things, and I remember that, I'll keep that. So it's just building up a little library of ideas. But you know, from the book, you know, in the book, you know, the guy's got a real drug habit, the character, he's called Chilly Willy. But I wanted to play the humor as well as the tragedy, you know? So I really got into that whole idea of like, when you take drugs, you know, that you just completely do it again to escape what you're doing. So there's a tragedy behind it. And a lot of drug addicts would rather spend their money on drugs rather than food. So then that made me realize, oh, okay, so I've got to lose a week, you know what I mean? And be a bit scraggy. You really get into that, don't you?
Like, you take that really seriously. Talk me through it.
Yeah, I mean, some people call it method. I wouldn't call it method because I like to know I'm aware, so I'm not completely lost in it. But with me, what I did was I went on a diet, okay? And I literally went on a diet and I lived a life without sugar and any salt, you know, and I've drunk lots of water and I was very aware of my health. So I took my right vitamins, do you know what I mean? But I took them in pure form. And I basically just sort of stayed away from everybody and lost all this weight and just spun on this bike and was hungry all the time and really miserable and couldn't be around anybody. And then when we got to filming, I remember we were filming in Scotland and they put me in a hotel room and I opened up the minibar and there was all this chocolate and all this food and all this
torture.
And I remember thinking, one more day of filming, just hold this weight down and you can eat all you want. So I remember just picking everything up, putting it in a towel, and leaving it out in the corridor and just asking someone to get it.
Get it out of sight.
You know, and so I just kind of got into it really. But the process for me really was just to kind of get to a certain weight level. And then with the weight level, certain traits would come, certain behavior would come, certain mood swings would come, you know. But I kind of kept it all contained and refined in a little bubble. And I just got the train up to Scotland and just was straight in this hotel room, kept myself to myself and literally just went straight on set and did it. And then about 6 or 7 weeks later, I had to put on a little bit more weight because the character was going to be, you catch up with the character 10 years later. So it was a physical challenge, you know, and the schedule moved around. So I had to starve a little bit longer than I really planned to and stuff. It was really hard, but the end result was everything. And that's kind of what it's about, really. It's just sort of about putting yourself through it and really being there. So I didn't take any drugs or anything like that. You know, I know enough about that subject. You know what I mean? I could read about it and see about it. And there's enough stories. And so I just kind of embraced all of that, really, and just believed I was in New York and I was, you know, a heroin addict. Yeah.
I mean, it can be quite, it was worth it because the performance I thought was absolutely sensational. It can be consuming, I would imagine, because it's definitely veering into the world of method acting, isn't it? Yeah, is that the furthest that you've taken it, do you think?
Well, no, I mean, that, to be honest, it was kind of pale in comparison to a film that I did called In the Heart of the Sea, which is a Ron Howard film. It was set in the 1800s about Moby Dick, and I played, we were all these seafarers, and you know, we all get abandoned at sea and we all had to go down to skin and bone. And that was with Warner Brothers. So yeah. I'd kind of done that process. And that was really hard. I mean, the whole job was a complete blur. But when it comes on at Christmas and I see it, I'm thinking, oh my goodness. I mean, so I was really underweight then. So I kind of, when it came to Patrick Melrose, I had a bit more knowledge, you know, sports science and nutritional, the value of everything. So I was in a really safe place. And as you can see, I'm not like a skinny guy, like, you know, I'm not like I was in Patrick Melrose, you know. So, and I'll do the same, you know, for putting on weight, you know. So yeah, that's kind of how it is. It was hard. It was hard, Charlie. I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah.
Wouldn't want to do it again, you know.
No. With those sorts of characters, Gary, can you leave them at work or do you find that you take them home with you?
Oh, babes, this is my biggest problem. You know, this has kind of struck some of the relationships I've been in without getting too personal. It's like, yeah, I'm going to lie. I think, I can't exercise the character straight away. No, I was playing a six-year-old at this play once, like a six-year-old. Literally, I had to play a six-year-old and do all the physical, idiosyncrasies, mannerisms. And I went to, we were taken to like preschooling nurseries and all this stuff to study these kids. And I could not get it out of my body. I was doing a whole thing, standing like it was so weird. And yet, no, I have brought characters home with me. That is something that I plan to get better at not doing so much. But I tell you, it is hard. I'm not going to lie, it's hard. I mean, if it's a character that you're really into, there are other characters you're like, yeah, I don't even know if I arrived with the character. I was just dialing it in, you know.
Yeah.
But most of the time, yeah, it's kind of, if you go there, it is hard. You do, I need a break. You do need a mental break, you know.
Meditate,
whatever, do something different, play sports, whatever it is you do, you know. So, yeah, I need to do that more, actually.
Important to keep your life active outside of the filming set, but difficult because the schedules can be grueling.
Yeah. As you well know, Charlie, we've worked together. We both know what it's like to be relatively young, stay professional and try to enjoy your life. It's just not possible.
It's quite hard. Although we could go.
You know what I mean? I say that all those, as soon as this lockdown's over, go out and enjoy yourself. I swear to God, just do it. Because yeah. I tell you, it's something that you can only do while you're young.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do it
now. Yeah, there you go.
When you the script lands on your desk, comes to your post box at home, what is your process? Talk me through opening the envelope to your first day on set.
Okay, I try to take the theatre thing with me in everything I do, even if it's my own theatre that I'm carrying around within me, okay? So if the script arrives and, you know, I've got the part and, you know, I read the whole script.
Yeah.
Like every detail. And I say, if you work on a script, read it three times straight, literally. And if you're on a job that's on longer than a week, if you're doing like 6 week shoot, I'd say read the script at least every other week. Just read it. Just read it again. You can never be too familiar. And you find so many things, you know. Okay. You find so many things. So reading the script is the first thing. Like,
quick question on that. Just a quick question. What do you say? I've heard of people that only read their bits.
Yeah.
Don't read the whole script. What do you think about that?
I think it's, look, everyone's got their own technique. That's fine. Yeah. You know, I'm not kind of here to judge that, but I mean, and I've done that myself. And I guess why I read all scripts now is because you can never know too much. I mean, you just never know too much. And, you know, a creative thing that's, you know, an overall view, you know, you're playing a part within it. And it's nice to know everything that's going on, to do your best to fit in, to fit into the genre, to fit into the style of the direction, to fit into the style of the story, you know. Yeah. You don't stand out like a sore thumb because you only read your bits. It's fine. You know, it may work. But I don't think it'll ever go against you if you read the whole thing. I don't know anyone went, oh, I read the whole thing and it ruined my performance.
Yeah.
I mean, that doesn't really happen. But, you know, there is a case of not reading everything and missing out on certain stuff, looking back and thinking, I could have done this. I mean, it's all part of the learning. So read the whole script. The whole script is what I said. But if it doesn't work for you, that's fine.
Even knowing what other people think about you within the script are all indications for your sort of detective work into the character, right?
Exactly. And you get information about your character from other people's perception of that character, don't you?
Yeah, totally.
About you in the scene that you're not there. Actually, you know, there's another element to you, you know.
Yes.
So
we've read the script three times.
Yep. So read the script three times. And then you kind of start going through your words, okay, your sentences, what you're going to say. Look at your story arc. Where does your character go? Where does it end up? Where does it start? And so get meaning behind everything you say. Get pictures in your head behind everything you say. Then when you say it, it just flows and it's natural and you know your train of thought, okay? And again, that's the last thing you need to worry about is why you're saying something. You need to know why you're saying a line, whatever line it is, no matter how small it is. And, you know, once you do that, I call it uniting, you know, you go through each one and then you write your take on what's behind that line. And I swear to you, before you know the line backwards, forwards, upside down, different inflections, different styles on all of that. You can actually, it becomes Play-Doh. You can do things with it.
Yes. That's where you can play.
Exactly. That's when you can have fun with it. Now, we've all done jobs when we've gone, oh, if I was doing it now, I'd do a better performance or a different performance. We all know this. So try to get that familiarity and you can have that chance. It's up to you, just matter how much time you put into it. So So own the words, know why you're saying them. And then out of that, you can start to mold your character. You start to mold your character's voice. How they talk. They talk high, they talk low, they talk with an accent. What's the attitude behind that, you know? And then you can get really into the physical stuff, you know, because I'm a great believer in that, you know, that you really should put the effort into your physical presence as well, you know, and study why that person may walk this way or stand this way, or, you know, how would they lean? How would they sit? And so when by the time you're on set and your director is coming with suggestions, you can just flip it. You can just manage it. Even if you think, oh, I don't like that, you can still give them an alternative that might, you know, meet in the middle, because you know your stuff. You can only do that. You know your stuff.
Question on that. Do you, and then we'll just go back to following the script process, do you offer something different every time? And do you think it's important to do that? Or is consistency important? Or should we give them variation? You know, like, what's your take on that?
So, you know, there's so many people in this world that do their own thing. And, you know, it can't be just one thing that works. You know, otherwise there'd be one type of actor, just one, you know. So for me, there's so many ways. You know, it's just so many ways you can do something. Do you know what I mean? So I'm not really, I mean, I don't subscribe to people just doing one way, you know. I'm more of a subscriber to trying to do things so many different ways. So when you give a performance, unless you're making an advert that says, you know, like, buy this chopstick, it's the best chopstick in the world, I endorse it because my name's Gary Beadle or whatever, and do take after take the same, that's a corporate thing. But if you're doing a dramatic thing, a theatrical thing, you'll do it differently.
Yeah. You'll
say it another way, You've got to give so many different performances, and each one should be consistent but different.
You know,
it's a fine balance, because you want to change things. You find things, and that's part of it. Finding new things is part of doing things different every time you do it. You know what I mean? Just like when you're learning it, you know.
100%. I think that's definitely true of theatre.
Yeah.
You know, when those words and that piece is under your skin and you're breathing it, every night is the most exciting, staring kind of opportunity to find something new. You know, I'm always at my most comfortable about 4 weeks into a run where, you know, everything is there and everything's running seamless, and then you can do like your actual gym workout, you know?
Absolutely. You can own it, literally own it. I saw you in Streetcar Named Desire, right?
You did.
Right? At the Curb, right? Leicester, right? I saw you on, and that's the first time I'd actually got to see you on stage, I think. I think it was the first time, isn't it? Yeah, I got to see you on stage, and you were a million miles away from the girl that I knew. You know what I mean? You were completely three-dimensional. And I'm pretty sure that every night was a tailored performance for the environment and the audience that you were in. And that's what we love, theatre. And I believe, you know, you can carry that into film and, you know, TV, because people can watch it and then they can watch it 10 years later.
Yeah.
So, you know, just, yeah, I'm a great believer, right, in just taking risks. And taking risk means doing something different every time. Every time you're given the opportunity, you know. And if it's recorded, they can choose. If it's theatre,
something different.
So everyone's a winner, right?
Yeah, yeah. This I love that the director goes, I've got that one. Let's try something else.
Exactly.
Okay, great.
Exactly. Try something else. Always try something else. Keep them guessing, you know.
Yeah.
I think keep them guessing and try to be, you know, kind of always changing and always open and, you know, ready to mold and adapt and move with different ideas, you know.
Yeah.
Much more fun to work with people like that, you know.
It is. It's exciting. It's exciting when you are with, and can be quite terrifying on stage when you're with someone who's just as daring or just as brave. You know, it can be like
hip-hop. Absolutely.
So back to the script process. We've read it three times. You've gone through looking for things in the character to create the physicality. What next?
Okay, so here's the thing. The next thing you do is you really listen to your artist that you're working with. You know, if you're doing scenes with people, really include them in your performance. You know, don't just think about yourself. Don't just go into yourself and think about yourself. This is where I kind of shy away from method, because, you know, I like to have my critical faculties aware that okay, someone else is doing something and what they're doing is really good. I know my stuff good enough to adapt with that and be help them with it or be part of it, you know, not just sort of stuck in my ways and thinking, oh, what they're doing is going against my, you know, you want everybody to be harmonious, you know. So listen to your fellow actors, your fellow artists, you know, listen to them and be, and that means everybody, you know, that means everybody with a suggestion. Do you know what I mean? Whether it's hair and makeup, whether it's direction and lighting, photography, everybody's a team, everybody's together. So you've got to be receptive to all of that, you know. So listening and
the top tip,
because if you like acting, you're not going to get anywhere without reacting. Do you like that? You see what I did there?
I like it.
reacting, you know what I mean, is something that you kind of buy into when somebody does something, and your reaction is your acting. That's what it is, reacting. So listen to what their dialogue says, you know, and learn their dialogue to a point. I mean, in theater, you know, I learn other people's dialogue. I literally learn other people's dialogue. Yeah, so so it's like a two-way thing, you know, in my head, you know, it makes me more instinctive. So, yeah, so you can't always do that, but, you know, with TV and stuff, because stuff changes. But
it's a good exercise, though, Gary. My acting coach often makes me read it with him, but read all the other parts first, because it might expose something that wasn't there before, you know?
Exactly. I did a play, once did a play, just not changing it too much, but I once did a play, LeBlanc, which you mentioned. We were all doing other people's lines. But before we did other people's lines, we were doing interpretations of lines. And it was like we didn't even do a read-through.
Talk me through that, interpretations of lines.
Well, kind of like,
improv stuff or?
So you got a scene, okay? So there's a scene. So there's a scene between me and you, okay? And I go, right, okay, we're going to do the dialogue, but we're not going to look at the script. But we know what's the meaning behind the dialogue. So we're going to improvise the meaning. That's what we're going to do. So if the line is, I need you with me, I can't live without you, then I'll talk about that subject in another way that means that. Do you know what I mean? Just use other words. And you're thinking, why am I saying the words that aren't, I'm not going to say on the day? But then you realize what you're actually doing is you're capturing, again, the thought process behind why you're saying the words.
That's so good.
And then all of a sudden, you just learn it. It's like, it doesn't even learn it. It just kind of materially appears in your head. You're learning. It's a different technique.
Because it's all about your lines will come if you know what the intention is.
That's my point. There you go.
You know,
that's a big one for me. You know why you're saying something. So you don't. Yeah. So if someone says to you, say what you're saying, but say it with other words, and people go, well, they might not know what they're saying, but if you know what you're saying, you can use other words, right? So it's that kind of thing. And it just, that's how that was a real trip. And that's something I learned quite recently. When I say recently, within the last 5 years, I was just like, you know what? That is something I'm going to take with me. So I hand that one out. Yeah. Learn the meaning behind your lines. Yeah.
I think we should come and do a workshop on that with a group of our IAMPRO community, Gary Beadle.
I'm up for that. I'm up for that. I'm up for that.
Pardon?
I said, how can I ever say no to you, my no.
Oh, God, I love it. That's so juicy. Who's the director of that, just out of interest? Because it may well be that show is on the National Theatre Live at the moment.
That's the woman called Yael Farber. Yael Farber. She's amazing. South African woman. Who lives between Canada and South Africa and London.
Right.
Amazing director. She's on Twitter. You can follow her. She's amazing. Yael Farber. Yeah.
Check her out and check out that play if you can. Back to the script. And is there any other part of your process that you think is important for young people breaking into this industry, important that you can impart with, that is important for them to know, that, you know, top tips, basically, on from what we've talked about?
Yeah. In terms of like, so for young people, do not ever... I'd say always be open to change. Like, don't build up principles that kind of hold you back or even stereotype you or pigeonhole you. Do you know what I mean? Don't be a slave to your principles. Always, always look to learn, to absorb. Because you can't know it all. You just can't. That's why we're allowed to act until we're 100. You know, that's why there's no retirement age in acting. Because there's so much more to learn. There's always something to learn. And So you must not build up principles. You cannot become stubborn. You can't say, oh, I'm just doing film, or I'm just doing theatre, or I'm just doing television, or I just want to be famous, but I don't really want to work for it. You know, these principles will just hold you back. These principles will just keep you limited. You'll be here today, gone tomorrow. You'll have no adaption. You'll have no ability to adapt to change and move with the times.
And grow.
Grow, exactly, right? So you've got to be able to keep your, not live by principles. I said, don't live by principles. You know, live by morality, of course, know what's wrong and right, but don't live by, you know, hardened principles that sometimes will slow you down. That's my top tip, you know. And so also make depression and rejection your best friend, because I tell you, as an actor, that's going to be around all the time. Them cats are going to be hanging with you all the time. So get used to them. And don't feel, you know, that if you're not working and you feel like shite and you're so depressed and down, that is so normal for actors. Like, you have to get used to that. You have to. I mean, otherwise, otherwise do something that requires you to be, you know, in a routine all the time, which is fair enough for your sanity. I get it. But if you've got a thing about the arts, you've got to learn to take rejection. You've got to learn to kind of go, it's not personal. It's just you're either it or you're not. And that's it. That is it, literally.
Did you have to learn that? Did that take you a while? Did you suffer, struggle with that in the early days?
Yeah. Goodness. I mean,
how did you overcome it?
It's weird. I mean, look, I was a child actor, so I started off nice, you know, bit of a sort of an artistic silver spoon. I was like, I was doing all right. I was acting as a child. And then, you know, you did a bit of TV and you're like, great. And then you do something like EastEnders and you're like, this is great. And then you leave EastEnders and then you're just like, ah, you're in this place and people kind of already got you in their mind and they might not be so imaginative as you are. And all of a sudden you're like typecast. All of a sudden you're like, how do I get out of this?
Yeah.
And my advice for something like that was, well, I went straight back to what I started in, which was theatre. And that's where I got my technique back. That's where I got my confidence back. That's where I learned to realize, actually, I don't have to be a slave to anything. And from theater, you know, things just got better again. So I always say theater through the hard times, theater through the good times, theater, bring back theater. We just got to bring back theater, really. That's the thing I want to talk about.
Theater is, yeah, we need it back in our lives because it is the heartbeat of what we do.
I agree. It's really important. It's so important.
Keep it simple. Theatre is the heartbeat of what we do as actors, I think.
Exactly. And I'm hoping, you know, that whatever happens, we'll always have travelling theatre, like the circus back in the day. You know, somebody will come into town, all the big parks will become theatres. You know, people will put up tents, whatever the COVID, you know, protocol is. People will be needed to be entertained where it doesn't cost them, a subscription of like £30 a month. You know what I mean? They can actually go to the park and see people need to express themselves. So theatre, the whole genre of live performance is so important for confidence, for technique, and for new things and new ideas. So, yeah, I always say keep your theatre if you want to stay sane. Even if it's Zoom readings, Zoom plays, whatever it is, stay in a community like that. Yeah.
Totally. Do you approach a theatre script differently to how you might approach a script for film or TV, just out of interest?
I'll be honest with you, I approach them all the same, right? Like I do with theatre. I mean, you can only work with the time you're given, right?
So, yeah.
You know, but essentially, yeah, I like to just go through the whole process of everything and bring everything to the table, you know, and have some real gravitas and some physical presence when you're there, you know. And just have it in your bones. Have it in your bones. Have it in your mouth, have it in your bones, have it in your heart and in your head, and it's just there. You know what I mean? So, and you can only get that if you literally just binge on research and rehearsals and technique and just, you know, it's a charmed life. I know, walking around, you know, brushing your teeth in your lovely little mirror going, da-da-da-da-da, saying your lines, you know. And you don't have to, like, go and, you know, empty your skip or do something real hard, like messing about, you know. But the time that you are given as an artist, you should use that time to better yourself. Technique, read, learn other languages and things like that. Do things that open you up and give you more and more and more confidence, you know? Yeah.
Absolutely. Gary Beadle, who is your inspiration? I think I know the answer to this.
Go on.
Ricky Beadle Blair.
Yes. I always say it, don't I? I always say it. It's just a matter of time. My big brother is everything to me. My brother Ricky Beadle Blair is my big brother, my best friend, my life coach, and parental guidance in many occasions, in many cases when we were growing up. So he's a total inspiration in terms of there's so much to learn and so much to live for. I mean, he chooses to see the good things amongst all the madness that's happening. And it's so important because there are so many good things. You know, you can go down that rabbit hole and being depressed and blah, blah, blah. I mean, that's just bad enough as an actor or just a human being in the... But with my brother, he's just like sunshine, pure sunshine. And he inspired me to, to just explore this whole business, you know? He is the true genius in my family, in my life, literally.
He's special. Yeah, he is special.
But he is very special, very dear to me, as you well know.
I do. Can I just ask you quickly what you do about nerves? Do you feel nerves? I'm a wreck. At the side of a stage, the day before a shoot, as you're about to walk on set, meeting new people, how does that affect you, and what do you do to kind of ease your way?
I totally get nerves. Now, there's two things about nerves, right? I'll tell you quick. The first one is, it's good. It's okay. You need that energy. You need that little bit of energy, right, of nerves. You need that. But you don't need to be overcome by it. And the way to avoid being overcome is, if we go right back to the beginning of the session, what did I say? You literally can never read a script too much. You can never study a line too much. You can never understand a story too much. You can never sort of explore your character, research more, and all those things. And that will put you in a place of knowing what you're doing. Doesn't matter if you're nervous, if you know what you're doing.
Yes, right. If you're underprepared, then there's a reason to be nervous.
That's the place none of us want to be. And it's an apprenticeship that I've experienced myself, and I wouldn't recommend it on anybody. Yeah, if you know what you're doing, all you need to do is take a deep breath and believe in yourself. Just that's literally it. But if you don't know what you're doing, the nerves are going to consume you. And it's something to learn from. And we've all been there. So,
I've learned a lot from that, you know, over the years, for sure.
Exactly. Last
question.
Sure.
What advice would you give to the little Gary Beadle or to any of our young creatives at IAMPRO hoping to break into the industry?
Yeah, I think my advice for the little Gary Beadle, would be, it would probably be to just actually believe in myself a lot sooner than I did. Do you know what I mean? Really, than I did, in terms of there's no black people on television, and you know, the parts aren't that great, and you know, I'll be entering a business where, you know, the chances are against me that I won't do well. You know what I mean? And all those things, you know. So I was kind of apprehensive in terms of, I never really took my job as a job. It was just something I did as a kid. It was like a hobby that I was still doing. And I thought, one day I'm going to have to sort of grow up.
Yeah.
And I never really took it really seriously in that sense. And I think now, looking back, I should have believed in my dreams a lot earlier than I did.
Yeah.
I was very, 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 my big brother's Ricky Beadle Blair. He was pure sunshine. Do you know what I mean? And, you know, I just liked hiding in his sunshine. There was a place for me in that. So I didn't have this urge to be anything. Do you know what I mean? You know, I never had the guts to think I could be. But, you know, along with my brother and good people around me, I started to believe in myself quite later than I should have done. And out of that, there's probably some negative behavior growing up, you know, moments in my life, that if I'd have just believed in myself a lot, I might not have been so self-destructive in certain ways, you know. But hey, everyone's got their own journey to get there. So that would be my thing, yeah.
Absolutely. But there's also, Gary, something really beautiful about that vulnerability, you know, that you, when you're younger, that you kind of sit in that, you know, and being open to that, I think.
Yeah.
I think I was definitely guilty of, like, when I'm just getting away with it at the moment, when I'm going to get hard up. Still have that occasionally.
Yeah, I'm the same as you. Exactly the same.
Yeah. I mean, we play for a living. That's what we do. We play.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, listen, one of the things about EastEnders, this is where my confidence kind of got knocked, but I kind of took it on under that purpose, because you know that I wanted to do that show because you was in it. That's the crazy thing. That's another story, but you know that, right? I literally couldn't wait
to remember you telling me.
Yeah. But my main challenge was, they say that people do that show I say, this is pretty dope. People do that show and they never work again. And I'm like, the gambler in me is like, I like the odds. I'm going to try and do something, then walk away and see if I can work again afterwards. A boy, it was hard. I wouldn't recommend it. But my confidence got not knocked. Easy. My confidence got knocked when I left and I couldn't get a job for love nor money for a period of time. Just for a period of time. I was like, oh my God, I've never been in this situation before. So, you know, what got me through it really at the end of the day was the people around me. But, you know, without them telling me that I could do something, I don't know if I would have done it. Do you know what I mean? And that's kind of, you know, that's kind of where I'm at with, like, I wanted to do it, but I didn't think I could.
Yeah.
And I don't think there's anything wrong with trying something that you want to do, even if you think you can't do it.
Yeah.
You know, you never know if you can't do it until you try it. So I've been really fortunate in that sense. But it's a crazy one, that whole thing of confidence and doing something, wanting to do something. Like, there's so many people that I'd be doing normal jobs now. I want to paint, I want to do this, but I'm just doing this. Their real talent or their real desire has been suppressed for whatever reason. And, you know, these things never go away. So you've got to embrace them at some point.
Listen, we've been brave. You've got, you know, happy to step outside of our comfort zones, I think. And that's somewhere you have to get, you have to get comfortable with being uncomfortable is what I've learned.
You know it. You know it. Honestly, you know, I got so much love for you, Charlie, because you're like Madonna. You're like reinvention. You're all about reinvention, man. I mean, that's what it's about, right? Keep them guessing. You know what I mean? Don't, you know, the characters you play are not you. You know what I mean? It's like, I know you. You know what I mean? And I know you can just take yourself there. That's the secret. You know, you've just got it. You've just got that going on. I have to throw that in there because I believe that. I really believe that.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. Thank you for being on this interview with me for IAMPRO. It will absolutely, a question of a doubt, help young people out there break into the industry. That is what we're trying to do at IAMPRO, keeping it accessible and affordable. I am absolutely blessed to have you. Thank you so much. And that's it.
Thank you, my darling. All my love.